the introduction, and I'm also thanks to the organizer for giving me a chance to present here. Yeah. I'm really, really happy about that. And my presentation, my work is a joint work with my advisor, Kiam Lee, and a Swedish student, Martin Stromquist. Yeah, this is a joint work. And let me introduce what is the obstacle problem first. I will choose omega, a bounded, open, and connected domain in Rn. And this is the general. And for given any function, psi, I will assume that it is in C2, but generally we can extend our result when psi is in the H1. We usually call it an obstacle. And for given boundary condition G, satisfying this comparability condition under the boundary, then we say U is the solution of the obstacle problem if U is the minimizer of this energy functional. And the function V is chosen in this set. The psi, the obstacle, performs as a constraint in this set. Okay. It is it is well known that there is a minimizer. We always find the minimizer U in this situation, and geometrically, it is the least spot solution of the harmonic equation, which is bigger than this. Yeah. That means this is our boundary, and this is an obstacle psi. Then our solution, the shape of our solution looks like this. Yeah. This is the super solution, which is bigger than this obstacle. Yeah. If the obstacle is only defined on the n minus 1 dimensional manifold, such as a hyper n minus 1 dimensional hyperplane, we call this problem a Signorini problem or thin obstacle problem. Yeah, I will mainly consider thin obstacle problem in this talk. So there is a formal definition about the thin obstacle problem, and the only difference is the obstacle is defined on gamma. That is the only one difference. And in this talk, and I will assume that the dimension is greater than or equal to 3. And for the simplicity, I will assume that the boundary condition is 0. And let me introduce the periodical background. For given any subset T, which has the smooth boundary, it's regular enough, and contained in a ball with radius half, we define T epsilon by multiplying T and a scale constant A epsilon. Yeah. So this is decays at a speed A epsilon. Yeah. And by arranging it periodically, we can obtain this picture. Yeah. So this is our periodical background. Now, for any given subset D over Rn, and for any given obstacle psi, we define D epsilon like this, and psi epsilon like this. This means if we choose D, a hyperplane like this, then the red lines are D epsilon. And the obstacle is non-zero on these red lines. So outside the red lines, it vanishes. So this obstacle oscillates highly as epsilon goes to zero. So suppose that U epsilon is the solution of obstacle problem when the obstacle is psi epsilon. So as I told you before, we only find this solution. So then our main problem is to determine the limit U of the solution U epsilon in terms of a limit equation it solves. We usually call it a homogenization. So we will characterize the U by using the equation. If D is chosen the whole space, then we call this kind of problem a highly oscillating obstacle problem. Yeah. And if I chose D, n-1 dimensional manifold gamma, then we call it a highly oscillating thin obstacle problem. This problem is what I am considering now. And to describe the limit equation, let me introduce the capacity first. Here is the definition of the usual capacity, right? So for given any function, any set A, we define the capacity of A like this. It is well known. And I will introduce the new concept of capacity to describe our limit equation. Yeah. Here is the picture. This is gamma. And this is the normal direction nu of gamma. And this is the translation of gamma with this amount. And this is just a t, not a t epsilon, this order one picture. Then this is the intersection. And I will define Fs by the capacity of this intersection, right? And I will define the directional capacity of T with respect to the direction nu by integrating F with respect along S. And this is my definition of directional capacity. So for each S, I calculate the capacity of S and integrate with this direction. Yeah. Then it is the directional capacity. Then the theorem is, in this situation, U epsilon converges to some U, and U satisfies this equation. Yeah. This is our main result. Okay. So if we choose A epsilon like this, and for almost every nu, not all nu, yeah, it holds us for almost every nu. In particular, if F is non-negative, U is the solution, then U is the solution of this equation. Yeah. Look at this term. Yeah. We usually call it a strange term because in our original problem, this term, that strange term doesn't exist. So that's why we call it a strange term. So. Okay. Here is some historical remarks. In 1997, I don't know how to pronounce those, but Shinonanescu and Murat proved that if the obstacle oscillates on the whole domain, and if we take the decay rate like this, then the solution converges to U and U satisfies this equation. Yes? This is a strange term in this problem. Also, they considered the thin obstacle problem. And they, when the gamma looks like this, and if they choose A epsilon like this, then there is a limit and U satisfies this equation. They also observed the strange term behavior here also. Yeah. And 2008, Caffarelli and my advisor Kiam Lee proved that they observed a similar result for the fully nonlinear operator F with homogeneous of degree 1. Yeah. In this case, the decay rate A epsilon is very much more complicated compared with the Laplacian case. However, it can be calculated by the constant gamma, and gamma is homogeneity of this special solution. Yeah. In 2009, Caffarelli and Melle proved a similar result when with this assumption. It means our periodical background T can be changed as K varies. But they just assume that the capacity is stationary ergo. In this situation, they proved the similar result by choosing A epsilon like this.
What is K?
K? Okay. Integer point. Okay. This integer point is K. K is just an integer point, and this picture distributed periodically. Yes. Then Caparelli and Melles, in a Caparelli and Melles assumption, the picture is changed as K varies.
Yes.
It contained in GN. Yes. Yes. Okay. So now I'm going to prove our main theorem. And the theorem can be proved by the constructing a corrector, constructing correctors, like satisfying those conditions. I'll assume that gamma is here, and I'll choose A epsilon like this. Then for almost all loop, there exists a solution satisfying those three properties, having those three properties. So W epsilon is 1 under on gamma epsilon. And it converts to 0 weakly in H1. And the limit of this converts to some non-trivial constant of this. Look at this term. This is very similar to the strange term. Actually, this will make the strange term. So, before proving this proposition, before proving the existence of correctors, then let me introduce why this proposition implies our theorem first. The most important lemma is the weak raw semi-continuity of the energy functional. Right? So, without this strange term, it's just a usual weakly raw semi-continuity. But because of this proposition and because of the constraint of the test function, we can show this non-trivial inequality. So let me sketch of the proof. By using the integration by part, we can easily show that this quantity converges to this. Yeah. And this with this identical inequality, we can easily show this. Yeah. So this is most important property of W epsilon. Right? So let's look at this. If I substitute 1 here, then it tells the energy of the corrector, the gradient energy of corrector converges to some non-zero constant. That is essential. If we converge to 0, we cannot see any non-trivial things. And if we converge to the infinity, then we cannot estimate anything. So this quantity is very important here. So after showing this, the remaining of the proof is just for the just a calculation, so I'll skip here. So once we construct a corrector satisfying in the proposition, once we construct a corrector in the proposition, then we are done. So now I'm going to construct correctors by defining corrector locally. So here is the picture. Here is, it is the one cell of our periodic background, TK epsilon. Yeah. And it is gamma. And suppose that gamma intersects with this. So there is an intersection. So I will define, I define double epsilon 1 here and 0 outside the ball with radius this amount. And I will extend double epsilon in here by using this equation. So here is the local definition of double epsilon. And I'll define double epsilon by adding all the local double epsilon k. Then the energy of double epsilon is defined like this. So now I'm going to calculate the energy of the gradient, energy of collectors. So by calculating the local energy of collectors. So I will calculate the energy of this, and suppose that WS is a solution looks like this. WS, here is, this is the origin, and this is the one cell centered at the origin, and this is a ball with radius epsilon over 2. And this is the, I'll assume that for simplicity, gamma is the origin is contained in the gamma, and this is a translation of gamma with this amount, and I will define W S epsilon 1 here, and 0 outside of the ball, and Laplace W epsilon S is 0 inside the ball. Yeah. This picture is very similar to this picture, right? So, and using the scaling, I will define W tilde epsilon S. So, the size of T is order 1 here, and the radius of ball converges to the infinity as epsilon goes to 0 in this picture after the scaling. And if I define large G epsilon like this, then small G epsilon, G epsilon, and large G epsilon satisfies this relation. Yeah. It is easy to calculate. And moreover, as epsilon goes to 0, this radius goes to infinity. So we can easily prove that large G epsilon converges to the capacity of the intersection. Yeah. This is the first observation about the energy of collector. Okay. Mm-hmm. So now, for any given E, this is gamma. I'll define gamma prime of E like a projection of the intersection of gamma and E. Then here is our main lemma. The energy of a collector converges to this value. So it is non-zero if E has an intersection with gamma. Right. Let me sketch the proof. Note that for given any k prime in this hyperplane, there is unique k above k prime such that this quantity lies in this interval. Which means, because if I fix k prime, then the integer point is distributed periodically with the periodicity epsilon. So we always choose such a k. And if T epsilon K and gamma have an intersection, then this value should lie between some intervals. So if I define t like this, then n, sorry, if it has, if it, it there is an intersection, then it should rise between them, right? Note that the length of this interval is has an order a epsilon, right?
Yes.
It goes to zero very fast. Moreover, this constant t determines the shape of intersection completely, because if I translate the intersection with this amount, we can easily show this. This is the t epsilon centered at the origin, and this is the translation of gamma with this amount. Right? So by using this, we can easily show that the local energy of this is same with this. So to calculate the total energy of the collectors, so this is the order one picture. This is T, and there is a constant C and D, which looks like this, and I will divide this interval into m intervals, m sub intervals. So each sub interval has the length with delta, with length delta, and I call the ith interval I of I. I will denote it I of I. Then if, as I told you before, if T, epsilon K, and gamma have has an intersection, then this quantity should contained in between C and D. So it should be contained in one of I of I. So we can obtain this representation. So now suppose that n epsilon is the all of k prime, such that epsilon times k prime lies in this area. So this is a total number of points what we are considering, and the a I of epsilon is the number such that this quantity is contained in ith interval. So note that TK epsilon is distributed interval with length epsilon. So this quantity is distributed in a unit interval, right? So I will assume that these points distributed uniformly. That means if I take some interval, then another one, the point which is contained in this set is proportional to the length of that interval. So with controllable error, right? So look at this. The length of the interval vanishes as the epsilon goes to zero. So that is main difficulty of our problem. Anyway, I will assume this. Then using the simple calculation, we can easily calculate the collector, energy of the collectors. So let's look at these red letters, because that's why I chose A epsilon. I will choose A epsilon to make this value of order 1. It is a usual method. Anyway, by using that option, we can easily show that the limit supremum of the energy is bounded by this quantity, and limit inf is bounded below by this quantity. So we prove the lemma. So by using this, I'll finish the proof of the proposition. Let me restate the proposition. And I should get this. Because of the definition of W epsilon, this is automatically true. So I will take value 1 in on here. And because this function is supported in an epsilon neighborhood of gamma, so it is not difficult to prove this quantity. So the main quantity is this, so, right? So I will sketch the proof of this. This is just a technical lemma, so I will skip this. And using the integration by part formula, the local corrector, Laplacian of the local corrector is divided into two measures. One is supported under the boundary of the big ball, and the other is supported on the intersection. So it is because of the integration by part. By using the integration by part formula, there are two boundary integrals. So one is here and the other is here. And the gradient term vanishes because of this. So we get the two measures. And we don't have to consider this term because our test function is zero under the intersection. So we don't have to consider it. So I'll define mu epsilon like this. Then our corrector has the value 1 on gamma epsilon. So this is zero on the gamma epsilon. So I'll take this function as a test function. So we have this formula. So from this we get this quantity. So we are almost done. So now some technical or calculations left, but it's just a calculation, so I will skip this. Okay, so now if we prove the uniform distribute, if the sequence T of K prime is uniformly distributed, then we are done. So this is our last. So let me first introduce some definitions about the uniform distribution sequence. So for given any sequence xj and for any integer m, we define a subset E of this interval. We define a constant A by A is the number of points xj which is contained in the set E. So it is a counting function, and with the sequence xj is uniformly distributed if for every interval a comma b, this quantity converges to the length of the interval. So that is exactly what we want, right? So there is a criterion that tells us that a sequence is uniformly distributed or not. So a sequence is uniformly distributed if and only if this holds. Yeah, this is the well-known lemma. We call it a Weiss lemma. So by using this lemma, we can easily show that the sequence k times, this is not a vector, this is just a constant. This sequence is uniformly distributed if alpha is an irrational number. Yeah. We easily show that by using this. So if we take alpha or irrational number, this is same with this. N over A is same with the length of the interval with controllable error. But we cannot apply this theorem directly in our situation because our interval changes as epsilon goes to zero. which means the length of interval goes to zero as epsilon goes to zero. It is our problem. And this is, it doesn't tell us anything about that, because if the length changes, then rho also changes. So we cannot apply this directly. So we need more about that. So let me introduce the discrepancy of the sequence. For given any sequence, looks like this, the discrepancy is the difference between the portion of this set, portion of this number, and the length of the interval. Okay? Because we will take the supremum, so this quantity, this error, doesn't depend on the choice of the interval. So that is the main point. So if we control this discrepancy, then we can apply this theorem to our case. So there is an awesome result about that. It is proved by Keston in 1964. The discrepancy, this is the discrepancy, and discrepancy converges to some constant with respect in the sense of measure. In particular, it converges to for almost every alpha. So the admissible set doesn't contain all the irrational number, but this estimate holds for almost everywhere. So by using this for almost every alpha, we can show this easily. So if alpha satisfies this quantity, then we denote alpha is in some set A. Okay. So by using this, I will prove the uniform distribute. I will prove that the TK is uniformly distributed in this sense. Yeah. So now I'm consider the sequence K prime alpha. K prime and alpha is a vector, and this is denotes the inner product of those two values. Okay, here is the lemma. As I told you before, n epsilon is the order integer point of all the integer point k prime contained in the projection of gamma. So, and in that situation, I'm considered this value, and A epsilon PC is defined by the number of TK epsilon, TK prime, T of K primes, which is contained in this interval. We do modulo one sense. Then, even the size of interval vanishes, we have this. So this is this number of this. This is proportional to the size of length of the interval with controllable error. So if we prove this, then we are done. Let me introduce the idea of proof briefly. First, assume that the projection looks like a cube. This is the projection of gamma intersect omega, and this looks like a cube. Then we fix a k prime here. This is not the same with the previous k prime. I'm sorry about that, but fix a point k prime. Then the integer point along these lines is just a one-dimensional property. So we can apply the Keston's theorem to this, so we can obtain this. For each k prime, this quantity, the difference with this and this is bounded by the discrepancy of the discrepancy. And So by using this, we can easily show that this is bounded by the discrepancy of this. So h is the number of points contained in this line. So we are learned when E is a cube, then by in the general case, we approximate it by a cubus. So after that, we can obtain the general result. So thank you very much.